we've been talking about characteristics of general first order PDE. So generally it's a nonlinear equation. Now let's talk about Cauchy problem for this equation. So we have this equation and some initial condition. So here x is again a vector, n dimensional vector with components x1, xn, u is a function of x, scalar function, and p is a vector of all partial derivatives, gradient vector. And our initial curve is given somewhere in n dimensional space where our axis change, and the dimensions of this initial surface is n minus 1. Right? Obviously, because it gives one condition. And so what would be different now compared to a quasi-linear case? So in quasi-linear case, we had our initial surface gamma, right? So here I put in, so to speak, horizontal plane all of the axes, and in vertical, well, it's kind of vertical-ish directions u and p. So we had in quasi-linear case we had only u. So what we've been doing, we had n plus one dimensional space for the graph. We had our initial surface, and we're determining our u sub zero from initial conditions, and then we were getting some surface here through which we just had characteristics passing through each point, and if everything is all of the conditions, transversality conditions are satisfied, we've been building m dimensional surface. So now we're doing this in 2n plus one dimensional space, right? We have n axes, n p's, and one u, right? 2n plus one dimensional space. And to be able to kind of repeat the constructions, we need to be able not only to find u from initial data, we need to find our vector p from initial data. And here, it may be a problem. So I wrote what might be different compared to quasi-linear case, because quasi-linear case is also included. So in quasi-linear case, we knew that we have a usual graph. That's what I was trying to show. But now we have one graph. So from initial conditions, we will be able to find only tangential components of our vector p. And that would be n minus one components, but not the transversal component. So we will need to use the PDE for this. And I was trying to, so that's what we will be doing, just using all of the formulas, but I was trying kind of to illustrate it in a simple example, so you understand what I'm talking about. So suppose we have this function u of two variables. Right, and it's a solution to some, say, PDE, and then we have initial condition, and suppose the example, we have a condition given on x1 axis, on one of the axes, and this is equal to, say, given function x1 squared. So, and then, of course, we have, for u, we have initial data, right? And we can define from here p1. We can just differentiate this function and we will get expression for p1. But how we can get something for p2? From initial conditions, we cannot. And to find p2, we have to solve our equation. So suppose this is our PDE, so then it depends on x1, x2, since I said that just in this example we have two variables, u, p1, and p2, equals 0. And we can find p2 from this equation, but we can do it only if the conditions of implicit function theorems are satisfied. So basically, I will be just repeating what I have shown here in a simple example, but just for the general case. I just wanted you to see the idea what we are trying to do before we write all of the formulas. Okay, let's write down the formulas that corresponds to implicit one function theorem in the general case, and of course we expect to have some Jacobian. Right, let's start building these conditions. So first we will start with our initial surface gamma, and let's write this surface gamma in this form, right? So suppose that each variable x1 can be expressed as a function of n minus 1 other variables. So we have x1, expression for x1, for x2, for xn, and we have now, and everything we write in the space where x's change, and then we will have this description of our initial surface gamma, or we can also combine all this equation and write as one single equation, x equal c of y in the neighborhood of some point in our spaces where x is change point y sub zero. And here if we use this equation, so we remember that x is this vector, n dimensional vector, and y is n minus one dimensional vector. And we also assume that our function c is degenerate, that is, if we make a Jacobian matrix, then it will have the maximum rank, and the maximum rank is n minus 1. So here I wrote this matrix. So this matrix has the entries. Here we have dpc with derivative with respect to y1, dpc2 with y1, pcn with y1, and second row will be everything, every function we differentiate with y2, and so on, and the last row would be derivatives, will involve derivatives with respect to y, and, oh sorry, so this would be y n minus first, the last of the last component of y vector. Right, so it has n minus 1 row vectors, and they are linearly independent, we suppose, and then it will be important the plane that they span. And having this, the initial condition, the whole condition, not just the curve gamma, but the whole condition, we can write as so u of ψ1, ψ2, ψn is equal u sub 0 of n minus 1 y variables. And then we differentiate this condition with respect to every y I, right? So if we say pick a specific I and we differentiate, so first we differentiate du dψ1, but ψ1 it is our variable x1. Right, so we write here du dx1, and then this x1 of ψ1 with respect to yi. Then du dψ2 or du dx2 and ψ2 with respect to yi. And we differentiate all of them, and we differentiate the right-hand side with respect to this variable yi. And then we can notice that du dx1, it is p1, right, and du dx2 p2 and so on. So, and then we have this sum which is written here, sum from k to 1. Here we have all p's and multiply by the corresponding derivative of the corresponding ψ with respect to yi and equals to right hand side. And since we have I changes from 1 to n minus 1, we will get here n minus 1 equation. And so I wrote this n minus 1 equation symbolically here, And then we can add our main equation, main differential equation, which is written here. Right, so then we will get total n equation, and here this n equation we symbolically can write as a single vector equation phi of y and p. So I copied this equation phi of y and p here, and we can solve this equation for p if the conditions of implicit function theorem are satisfied. That is, if exists a point y naught p naught such that phi at this point so that satisfies this equation, and maybe it's better to put zeros on top because both y and p here they're vectors right at this point. And in subscript I write components, and so the point belongs, and also differential right does not degenerate of phi with respect to p does not degenerate, and then we will be able to reconstruct our one graph of function u in the neighborhood of this point if some Jacobian is not zero. So here I wrote this Jacobian. We have already seen the first n minus one rows, right? We mentioned that they are these row vectors are linearly independent and they span a plane, and this plane is a tangent plane to our initial surface gamma, and the fact that all n rows are linearly independent tells us that this plane made out of the first rows is transversal to the last vector, right, the last row. So it means that so if this is tangent plane to our surface gamma, it means that this vector is transversal to our surface gamma at this point. So the condition when this Jacobian is not vanishing is the transversality conditions between gamma and vector fp in this case. Okay, and now let's make a few comments how we can recover conditions that we discussed for a quasi-linear equation from the point of view of the general theory. So suppose we have a quasi-linear equation, but let's treat it first as a fully non-linear equation. So in this case, if you remember, for quasi-linear equation we had this form, right? So we have derivatives times some functions that depends on our independent variables and u as well. And here I just put this function from right to the left hand side. And so we can see the structure that if we want to treat this quasi-linear equation as a fully non-linear equation, then our function f would be exactly all this expression, and here we can see that this can be written as a dot product of two vectors, vector v and vector p, right? So this is and this function f. So in our case, in quasi-linear case, function f capital has this structure. And now let's try to see how we can simplify characteristic equations, system of ODE for our case. So in fully nonlinear case, we have this system of 2n plus 1 equations. We have equation for x's, right, for u's, and for p's. In quasi-linear case, we have only equations for x's and u's. So now let's see what we have here. If we, in quasi-linear case, if we put here fp, so this is our f, And when you differentiate with respect to P, we will get V. So this equation, that's what we had. We had an equations like this. And to get equation for U, we have here du dt, it's written P times F of P. So then it would be P, F of P, we know it is V, so P, PV, and then from here, from this equation, PV is F plus F capital plus F small. So then here we have F capital plus F small, and then since F capital equals zero, we have just small f. And so we can put these two equations here, so we have dx dt equals v and du dt equals f. And we can see here that nothing depends on p, so we do not need these extra equations for p. And also we can mention that characteristics of quadrilinear equation when it's treated as a fully nonlinear equations, they are given in the space of x, u, and p, 2n plus one dimensional space. And if we project from this space to space where we have only x and u, n plus one dimensional space, then they will become characteristics of quasi-linear equation. And finally, the condition that a point is non-characteristic fp would be, if we compute, it would be equals to v, and this is the transversality condition that we had, and vector v must be transversal to gamma at a non-characteristic point. And of course here we have a dot product, you probably figured this out. Thank you.